How many of you remember The Sweet Life of Zack and Cody? It was a Disney show about two twins that lived in a hotel and always got in trouble. Zack was the reckless rebel one, and his twin brother Cody was the sweet, charming, well-behaved one. However, it's interesting that they were twins, identical twins, meaning that their DNA was 100% the same, like literally the same, yet they could not be more different. But why? Well, genes are important. They do define us to a certain extent. But behavior and environment are also important. Environment can, in a way, shape your genetics. But here's the thing. Environment can have an effect in your genes, but it doesn't really change your DNA. The DNA stays the same. What changes is the way your body reads these genes. These reversible changes are what we call epigenetics, a fairly new field of study. What it consists of, in a nutshell, is turning genes on and off. So you know, identical twins are a scientist's best friend for many reasons. For example, to study epigenetics, they could not be more perfect. It's two people that are born with exactly the same genetic material, meaning it allows us to study the impact of environment and behavior in development and health. So an interesting fact is that twins, when they are born, they have practically no difference when it comes to epigenetic tags, whereas these differences increase the older they get. And actually, these differences are stronger the less of their lifetime that these twins spend together. Let's use Zack and Cody again for an example. Imagine for a second that Zack has an overall poor health as a consequence of an unhealthy lifestyle. He smokes, he's constantly stressed, and follows an unhealthy diet. Cody, on the other hand, doesn't smoke, works out regularly, and eats healthy. You know where this is going. Chances are that Cody will have an overall healthier life than his twin brother Zack. But let's analyze what's going on a genetic level. All these factors, what Zack and Cody are exposed to, can cause epigenetic changes. These can have a positive or a more rather negative effect. To understand how epigenetics affect age, development, and health, first we need to understand what epigenetics are. So let's start from the beginning. Our genetic information is stored in our DNA. The segments in the DNA that contain a specific set of information are called genes, and they have names like TP53 and stuff. These genes can play a role in many different processes, like muscle growth, immune system, or tumor formation. But as I just said, literally 1 second ago, this is information that is stored in our DNA. If these genes are just sitting there in the nucleus of the cells doing nothing, they're not really helping us much. Which means that in order for them to do their function, they need to be expressed. And in biochemistry, gene expression is the process by which the instructions in our DNA are converted into a functional product, such as a protein. And here is where epigenetics come into play. Epigenetic changes can affect gene expression, making a gene able or unable to be expressed, sort of like an on and off switch. And this can happen through different mechanisms. So, remember that the instructions in our DNA can be converted into proteins? Well, somebody has got to read this information, right? This is Peter. Peter reads the DNA so it can be later translated into protein. For that, Peter needs to attach to the DNA. The epigenetic changes will mostly allow or prevent Peter to attach to the DNA. And the main ones are adding a little chemical group to the DNA so that the DNA cannot be read and therefore the genes cannot be expressed. This is called DNA methylation. Histone modification. Some genes are wrapped around proteins called histones, which makes them inaccessible to Peter. Chemical groups can be added to these histones for genes to be unwrapped, so the genes are turned on, inaccessible to Peter, or wrapped, and the genes are turned off, inaccessible to Peter. And non-coding RNA. I won't go into much detail about what non-coding RNA is because I don't wanna make this video even more complex, but it can also affect gene expression. And it does so by either, for example, attacking Peter or recruiting other proteins to do basically the same things that we've said before. Okay, so now you know what epigenetics are and how it works. But what role does it play in our lifestyle? As stated in a super interesting scientific review that I will link down below, there are several lifestyle factors that are suspected to modify epigenetic patterns, such as diet, obesity, physical activity, tobacco smoking, alcohol consumption, environmental pollutants, psychological stress, and even working on night shifts. Let's take food, for example. Back to our Zack and Cody example. So Zack, in this imaginary scenario, isn't really what you would say a healthy person. He eats tons of fatty food, like the bad type. And there is evidence that a diet rich in polyunsaturated fatty acids could increase the presence of free radicals and oxidative stress, which have been linked to epigenetic alterations that are related to even tumor-related processes. Whereas Cody, super healthy dude, eats tons of greens, tons of fruit. In particular, he loves soybeans. Why? Because they're rich in polyphenols. And some of these polyphenols have a positive epigenetic effect, among so many other benefits. As a matter of fact, soy consumption is correlated with a reduced risk of hormone-related cancers. Disclaimer, I'm oversimplifying this for educational purposes. No, you won't 100% have cancer if you eat a burger every day. And no, you won't 100% be the healthiest person alive if you eat a bowl of soybeans for breakfast every day for the rest of your life. Another example is obesity. It is thought that certain foods can alter DNA methylation and therefore contribute to obesity through epigenetic mechanisms. Physical activity also has an impact on epigenetics. Some scientists believe that physical activity can increase DNA methylation in genes associated with inflammatory responses. So, higher physical activity can mean more DNA methylation in these genes, which means less inflammatory response. DNA methylation in these same sequences has been shown to be related to lower incidence and mortality from ischemic heart disease and stroke in elderly people. However, we cannot confirm that this is a direct consequence of physical activity. That will take more time and more evidence to confirm. Let's talk about one of the most interesting studies done in the field of epigenetics, the Dutch hunger winter. Environment can have an effect in our genes as early as before we're even born. And the best example of this is the Dutch hunger winter. From 1944 to 1945, the Nazis blocked the food supply to the Netherlands, resulting in a famine where more than 20,000 people died of starvation. And the children that were born during this time were not only affected when they were kids, but for their entire lives. As adults, they ended up being more overweight than average. They had higher levels of LDL and cholesterol, showed higher rates of schizophrenia, diabetes, and obesity, and even had higher mortality rates after age 68. Scientists studying this tried to find a connecting pattern, epigenetic tags that maybe these people had, but their siblings didn't. And they found a few methyl groups that were linked to both the famine and the health conditions later in their life. And this is very interesting for different reasons. First, it implies that stressful conditions during pregnancy can affect kids before they're even born. And second, if these epigenetic alterations are really the cause of the health conditions that these people experience later in life, which isn't 100% clear, this could mean that we could detect epigenetic patterns that can lead to health problems early in life. And we could then treat it and prevent it accordingly. So now we know that epigenetic changes can be influenced by a person's experiences. Therefore, could there be a chance that this is inherited? That things that we experience can have an impact in our genes to such an extent that we can pass it down to our offspring? Could it be that maybe Lamarck was right all along? Well, not exactly. I mean, as unconventional as it may sound, there is quite significant evidence that epigenetics can indeed be inheritable. This is rather new, and it's something that scientists are still trying to sort out in this very moment. And based on the research that I've done for this video, there doesn't seem to be any real agreement. So there's a group of people that say, hello, epigenetic changes are totally inheritable, can't you see? And there's another group that's like, it's not that simple. Let's dig deeper into this. But in any case, if the question is whether epigenetic changes can be inherited at all, the answer is yes. And this is called transgenerational epigenetic inheritance. And how can that happen? Well, when the sperm cell and the egg fuse, a process called reprogramming takes place, in which the cells go back to a blank state. And that means deleting all epigenetic tags. However, there is a small number of tags that go unnoticed and are therefore inherited by the offspring, leading to what we call parental imprinting. And there are quite some experiments that suggest it. For example, the agouti mouse, the overcalic study, where it was observed that a man's poor food supply and a woman's good food supply can be correlated with their kids having a lower chance of cardiovascular death. It's important to know that when we talk about inheritance and epigenetic changes, we're always referring to germinal cells, so sperm cells and eggs. Any epigenetic alterations that happen in a muscle cell won't have any impact in your offspring. Let me know if you're interested interested in the inheritance of epigenetics, and maybe we can do a video about it. Can you imagine a world where we could design our babies and select the traits we want our babies to have? Is that even possible? Check this video to find out.